Welcome, comrades, to the Spectre of Communism podcast. If you're watching on YouTube as opposed to listening on Spotify or Apple, then you might notice that we've had a bit of an upgrade to our media room and we'll be adding to our setup for subsequent episodes. But we are here to deal with the theory of permanent revolution developed by Leon Trotsky. And I would say one of the most deliberately abused and misunderstood theories in the whole of the Marxist canon. And today we're very happy to have with us Josh Holroyd, who is a leading member of the Revolutionary Communist International, to explain definitively what the permanent revolution is and, more importantly, what it is not.
A specter is haunting Europe. The specter of communism.
Communism is stronger, more determined than ever.
Communist.
Communism.
The communist.
The communist.
The communist.
Dedicated to the establishment of a new order.
Just what is communism?
So, Josh, let's get right into it. Can you explain, in a sentence or two, what actually is the theory of permanent revolution?
Okay. Well, when he set out to summarize his theory, Trotsky used the expression that the permanent revolution is revolution that does not make any compromise with any single form of class rule. Now, what that means is it's revolution that does not stop itself at any predetermined or artificially selected stage, that pursues its historic tasks continually across national borders, and is only truly complete with the abolition of class society itself. Now, in particular, one thing I'd add is what that means in countries where their capitalist development has been held back, say, by imperialism or by, you know, still in semi-feudal conditions like Russia in the 20th century. What permanent revolution means is that communists in those countries should not limit themselves to simply trying to establish a more democratic form of capitalist rule or to prop up and support the capitalist class in developing its own economy, but rather communists should strive for the greatest possible political independence of the working class, should strive to win the leadership of the oppressed majority of the whole of society, which includes the peasantry, and to struggle for the seizure of power and the overthrow of capitalism.
So Trotsky developed his theory on the basis of his experiences of the 1905 revolution, in which he played a leading role at the head of the St. Petersburg Soviets. Subsequently, his theory has become a bit of a line in the sand between Trotsky's contributions to Marxism, which we would describe as the authentic tradition of Marxism and Leninism, and the ideas of Stalinism, Marxist-Leninism. A lot of these are based on misconceptions about what Trotsky actually argued, misconceptions that were deliberately cultivated starting from the 20s. And we're going to deal with some of these in the course of this episode, starting with probably the most common, which is the idea that permanent revolution means you have to have a revolution break out everywhere, all over the world, simultaneously, in order for the working class to take power anywhere. And just so that we don't give the impression of being unfair or misrepresenting, I have tried to pull out some quotes from people who put themselves in the Marxist-Leninist tradition, making these arguments. For example, we have José María Sison, who is the, or was at the time of writing this, the chairman of the Filipino Maoist KM organization. He says, "They repeat the old rotten line of Trotsky, the revolution in any country is futile unless it is synchronized with a spontaneous and seamless world revolution. This is the stupid idea of having a permanent revolution, but not having a revolution anywhere if there are no simultaneous revolutions on a world scale." Well, I have to agree, that would be a stupid idea. But is that what Trotsky actually argued, Josh?
No, it's not. At no point has Trotsky ever put that idea forward. And you don't just need to take my word for it. He led, along with Lenin, the October Revolution of 1917. That was not a simultaneous or spontaneous world revolution that took place in every country. It took place in Russia. And in 1905, likewise, the strategy that he put forward for 1905 was not for the Russian workers and peasants to wait for the revolution to break out everywhere at once. It was to pursue the revolution to its conclusion. That's precisely what permanent revolution means. It means it begins somewhere and it continues to develop. It continues to struggle to overcome all barriers, including national barriers. So the point of permanent revolution is not that you tell the masses don't rise up, which is an absurd idea on its own anyway, but rather that a revolution that commences should be linked up with the world revolutionary process and spread, consciously spread across the world. And I would add that this isn't just Trotsky's position. It's identical with that of Marx writing in the 1850s. Even before then, even Marx writing in the 80s and Engels writing in the 1840s, but also Lenin. Lenin founded the Communist International precisely as an instrument of world revolution. Not because he believed in a spontaneous and seamless world revolution sprouting up out of every country at once, but precisely because he saw the need to spread the revolution. And he spoke explicitly about transforming the national dictatorship of the proletariat, the worker state established in Russia, in the Soviet Union, turning that into an international dictatorship of the proletariat by spreading to other countries. So I'd say this is simply the Marxist revolutionary strategy.
Yeah, it's really interesting that this is still used as a stick to beat Trotsky with, because at the time that he was developing his theory in 1905, and if you read Results and Prospects, which is where he first articulates the theory in its complete form, he's deliberately and specifically criticizing the increasingly reformist leaders of the Second International who argue that Russia basically has to wait its turn in the revolutionary process that they argued, following a mechanical interpretation of something that Marx had said decades prior, that revolution would have to begin in one of the advanced capitalist countries, say Britain or Germany or France, and backward absolutist semi-feudal Russia was somewhere at the back of the pack. And Trotsky basically says, look, Marxism is not an analysis of texts, it's an analysis of historical processes, and you can't formalistically impose a model on the living forces of the Russian working class and peasantry. They not only can have a revolution before the workers in the more advanced capitalist countries, but you begin to see that process unfolding in the course of 1905.
The reason that Marx tends to write about revolutions beginning in countries like France and Germany is because he's writing at a time when revolutions had just started in France and Germany. Marx was writing in 1850, looking forward to a resurgence of the revolution movement in Germany. In other words, he was analysing concretely the processes actually taking place. He never ordained, shall we say, that a revolution or proletarian revolution could not take place outside Europe. He never said that. What he did say is that the socialist revolution, the real socialist transformation of society, is only possible if the revolution, wherever it starts, finds its completion in the overthrow of capitalism in the most dominant advanced countries, which in his day was England.
That leads us rather neatly into the second of the most common allegations leveled at the theory of permanent revolution, which is that it's Eurocentric. So this is one of the trendier allegations. It does have a bit of a connection to the historical criticisms of people like Bukharin and later Stalin about Trotsky underestimating the peasantry, but we'll come back to that. But this argument that because Trotsky argues that it's necessary for the socialist revolution to be completed for a revolution to break out in the advanced capitalist countries, therefore, he's saying that basically the workers and peasantry in the oppressed, dominated, colonized countries, again, have to sort of wait their turn. And just to make sure that I'm not being unfair, I have a quote from a self-described Marxist-Leninist academic, Robert Beale, who says, "The Eurocentric view, in its most extreme form, is represented by Trotsky. He held that the future of the Russian Revolution depended on what happened in Europe, in contrast to Lenin's revolutionary faith in the peoples of the East." Now, if you've read Lenin's writings on the run-up to the Russian Revolution, you will know how completely back to front this argument is, because Lenin consistently argued, actually, that the Russian Revolution was part of a European-wide revolutionary process. What I find really galling about this is that Trotsky is specifically writing about the inevitability of the Russian workers. And let's be clear, Russia was not an advanced Western capitalist country. It was a backwards country in the East, semi-feudal, with a very large peasantry, and Trotsky is arguing that the workers of Russia will lead a revolution. There will be a proletarian revolution that will initially carry out bourgeois tasks and will grow over to socialist tasks. And it's not limited to Russia. The theory of permanent revolution is demonstrated in country after country where revolutionary processes have begun that we would not describe as advanced Western capitalist countries. Take China in the 20s, for example.
Absolutely, and it applies even further afield. I mean, the 20th century is the century of permanent revolution, in my opinion. But yeah, in the 1920s, when Trotsky is having the bulk of these debates over the permanent revolution, what was the situation in China? China was not even a unified country at this point. It's been parceled up between competing warlords, each of whom was backed by a different foreign imperialist power. And so one of the main tasks of the Chinese Revolution, which broke out in 1925, if I'm not mistaken, was the unification of the country, the end to landlordism and warlordism, and the modernization of the country that the masses were striving for. That does not necessarily lead instantly and directly to the socialist revolution. But Trotsky, consistent with his position in Russia, was putting forward the idea that these tasks, these aims of the revolution in China, could ultimately only be achieved by the workers at the head of the oppressed masses and the peasantry, overthrowing the bourgeoisie. What was the leadership of the Comintern arguing for at that time? It was actually that the workers should abandon any independent activity and should form the left wing of the bourgeois democratic Kuomintang, bourgeois democratic army fighting for the liberation or the unification of the country under Chiang Kai-shek. Who had more faith in the peoples of the East? Was it the Comintern leadership that was saying that actually the masses need to leave the bourgeoisie and also landlords that were included in this party, in the army, to carry out their tasks essentially on their behalf? Or was it Trotsky who was saying that they should actually take the country into their own hands and transform it? I would say that that showed more revolutionary faith in the peoples of the East. I would also say, and I think this is an important point, that Beale here is counterposing Trotsky to Lenin. Trotsky is constantly looking to the West. Everything depends on the revolution in the West. Lenin is looking to the East, and he has faith in the struggle of colonially oppressed people in the East. It's certainly true that Lenin considered the struggle against colonialism in the East and other dominated countries to be an essential part of the world revolution. Trotsky also considered that. But it's this counterposition between the two is completely false. At the same time that Lenin was talking about emerging revolutions in Eastern countries, he was talking about the absolute necessity of those revolutionary movements against colonialism linking up with the revolution movement of the proletariat in the West. Marxism is internationalism. It is an internationalist outlook. Lenin founded the Communist International as a worldwide party of revolution to unite the struggles in the East and the West. And what did Lenin say about the Russian Revolution? He said that if the revolution did not succeed in spreading to Germany in particular, in other words, advanced countries to the west of Russia, it was doomed. Lenin was explicit in the absolute necessity of the revolution spreading from the more economically backward Eastern countries to the more advanced West. Why is that? Is that because he was a Eurocentric bigot or because he had a Marxist understanding of the world economy and the nature of capitalism in the period that he was writing in? He was looking to the West because these more advanced capitalist countries dominated the world economy. They had a larger proletariat. They had more advanced technology. So that meant that not only could they put extreme pressure on any revolutionary regime in the East, but perhaps even more importantly, if the workers of those countries succeeded in overthrowing capitalism, they could give enormous aid to the development of the economy in any revolutionary Eastern state. That was Lenin's position. Trotsky's position is identical. What he's saying is that the revolution can, in fact, most likely will begin in a more backward country, But it must spread to the more advanced capitalist countries. Otherwise, it can be isolated. It will struggle to further develop its economy. And the potential for world socialism will be squandered. Lenin and Trotsky's position is absolutely identical. And any label of Eurocentric to that is utterly meaningless. I think now's probably a good time to discuss this question of democratic tasks. Because I think there has been and can be a lot of confusion about it. What do we mean when we say the tasks of a revolution? Obviously, a revolution is not a single conscious entity that has a shopping list of things to do. But what is a revolution? Trotsky, in his History of the Russian Revolution, offers, I think, a fantastic definition, which is the entry, the forcible entry of the masses onto the stage of history. In normal periods, the vast majority of the population are barely involved in politics, let alone actually taking the fate of society into their own hands. Whereas in a revolution, you have, I mean, often, you know, you can see it physically with the masses streaming out onto the streets. But even without those kind of scenes, what you have is ordinary people, ordinary men and women, taking their fate and the fate of society into their own hands. Why does that happen? Revolutions like that happen. They don't simply happen because individual charismatic leaders or revolutionaries have told them to do it. If that were the case, you know, we could try and launch a revolution tomorrow.
Yeah, we've got plenty of charismatic individuals in our organization. Yeah. Why not?
Well, exactly, yeah. And they don't just happen at random either. They happen for objective reasons. That the contradictions in society have built up to such an agonizing degree that actually the masses cannot continue living on this basis. That society and the social relations that have evolved in a previous period have created massive barriers for further development and progress. And so let me take up a concrete example as what was society like in Russia at the turn of the 20th century? It was semi-feudal. What that meant is, although serfdom had been abolished, you still had the exploitation of a mass of poor peasants by massive landowners, feudal landowners.
And not only that, but the peasants were made to pay the cost of abolishing serfdom.
Yeah, so some form of semi-feudal exploitation was maintained. You had an absolute monarchy in place, so basically an immense bureaucratic dictatorship headed by the Tsar. But at the same time, Russia is not an island and it's not independent from the rest of the world. Capitalism was developing in Russia, with foreign investment coming in, building actually some quite advanced and large factories, even by European standards. Mm-hmm. And you have the creation of a working class in Russia, which didn't exist, by the way, when Marx was writing. Now, this creates a big contradiction where the further development of Russia on a capitalist basis, we're not even talking about socialism at this time, is massively coming into conflict with the division of land ownership in the countryside, with the massive dead hand of the Tsarist bureaucracy and the old aristocracy, who were incapable of leading society anymore. Now, back in the 18th century, that produced huge bourgeois revolutions like the French Revolution. Why do we call it a bourgeois revolution? Because it helped to lay the basis for further capitalist development, industrialization, and ultimately it put the bourgeoisie, the capitalist class, rather than the feudal aristocracy in power. So when Marxists talk about things like bourgeois or bourgeois democratic revolutions, that's what they're talking about really, the contradiction between old, defunct social relations and political forms with further capitalist development. Now, what that meant was that some people, a lot of people, including the Mensheviks, in Russia at the time.
Mm-hmm. Mensheviks being the reformist wing of the Russian Social Democratic Labour Party. Mm-hmm. Initially a faction, eventually split away, became a separate party, distinct from the Bolsheviks led by Lenin, who maintained a consistent revolutionary position, insisting on the class independence of the proletariat, whereas the Mensheviks were looking to the bourgeois liberals and they had illusions in the bourgeois liberals.
Well, yeah, exactly. Where did the illusions come from? They came from the fact Russia is a backward country. It's not as advanced as, say, France, where you have a bourgeois republic. So they thought, yeah, revolution in France, nice and simple. It's the working class overthrowing the bourgeoisie. Mm-hmm. In Russia, not so simple. Actually, because many of the tasks achieved in France in the 18th century have still not been achieved in Russia, the revolution will therefore be led and the task must be carried out by the liberal bourgeoisie.
And again, when we say tasks, at this point we're talking about, you know, democracy, we're talking about land reform, we're talking about freedom of speech, freedom of assembly, we're talking about the elementary democratic rights that you associate with a modern society.
Questions of land reform, the overthrow of the bureaucracy. So what they're saying is because it's a bourgeois revolution, it must be led by the bourgeoisie. Therefore, what is the role of the working class? What is the role of the working class's parties? It's effectively to be the left wing of that movement. Now, what Lenin and Trotsky were both saying is actually it is ruled out that the liberal bourgeoisie will lead this revolution and carry out these historic tasks like land reform, like the democratization of the state, so like a parliamentary regime.
Quickly interject with the example, actually, which illustrated this in practice for Trotsky. In 1905, you had this banqueting campaign that was based on the experience of the French Revolution, where the bourgeois liberals got together and they developed a series of demands for reform, for constitution, for freedom of speech, freedom of assembly, a Duma, so a parliament. But ultimately, they were not the ones who were able to extract any concessions out of the Tsar. The constitution that was offered by the Tsar under the pressure of a general strike in October 1905 was won by the working class, not by the bourgeois liberals. They played no role, really. No fundamental role. And later on, when the working class started demanding the 8-hour day, for example, they did a 180-degree turn and started attacking the working class, excoriating them in their press, saying the revolution was going too far. So Trotsky wasn't just theorizing this out of thin air. He'd lived through this process. He'd seen the incapacity of the bourgeois liberals in Russia to accomplish even their own tasks. It was on the strength of the workers and their general strike that the autocracy was forced to blink.
Absolutely. And I mean, Trotsky even foresaw this before the events, because what he grasped was the nature of the bourgeoisie.
Right.
But not simply the nature of the bourgeoisie in all periods, but the nature of the bourgeoisie in a period where imperialism now dominates the world market. And he made a very interesting point that it's not simply that the liberal bourgeoisie is unwilling to carry out the tasks of its revolution, but it's completely incapable. Why is that? That the Russian bourgeoisie was so weak and so dependent and tied to Tsarism and also to foreign banking, foreign imperialism, it had no interest whatsoever in carrying out land reforms. The mortgages on the landlord's land was a great source of profits for foreign finance capital, upon whom the Russian bourgeoisie were also dependent. So Trotsky was saying it's ruled out that liberal bourgeoisie is going to play any progressive role in this revolution. As you already sketched out, it was the working class that basically were the battalions of the revolution, who carried out the fighting force of the revolution, and that is very often the case. You can see that even further back in history. But it's not just that in the past, when the bourgeoisie was capable of playing at least some kind of progressive role, I mean the first half of the 19th century, for instance, the workers would do most of the fighting and dying on the barricades. The liberals would still then walk in and introduce some kind of reform from the top. In this case, the Russian bourgeoisie just sided openly with the feudal, semi-feudal counter-revolution. So they weren't even prepared to open things up a little bit because they were so terrified of the working class in particular, but I guess you'd say the masses in general, and because they actually had no objective interest in carrying out that revolution. So Lenin also drew exactly the same conclusion. Lenin, to the best of my knowledge, Lenin never entertained the idea that the Russian bourgeoisie could play anything other than a reactionary, by which I mean a counter-revolutionary role, in its so-called bourgeois revolution. Trotsky, Lenin, and the Mensheviks all agreed, however, that the tasks confronting this revolution were bourgeois democratic in nature, for the reasons that we've already explained. So nobody, even Trotsky, wasn't saying that, actually, let's just forget about all that and begin directly with the socialist revolution. So how does that link with what I was explaining before about the passage of the democratic revolution into the socialist revolution? Because again, a misconception is that Trotsky's saying, well, let's just skip the whole thing. The workers just take power on their own. That's not what Trotsky was saying. What Trotsky was saying was a lot more nuanced and fundamentally confirmed by events. What he was saying was, well, these tasks are not just a shopping list of things that we'd like. These are objectively necessary historic tasks for further development. If the bourgeoisie isn't going to carry them out, can the petty bourgeoisie, what I mean by that is middle class layers, artisans, small business owners, who in past revolutions had played a radical role, like in the French Revolution, the sans-culottes. Are we going to have a repetition of the revolutionary convention of the French Revolution? He ruled that out as well. He pointed to the fact that actually, even in Marx's day, the radical petty bourgeoisie often prevaricated, looked both ways, and themselves were afraid of the movement of the working class, because they are property owners, after all. He ruled out the idea that we would have this independent petty bourgeois revolution. Can it be the peasantry, which was the majority of the population in Russia at the time? So it's not a ridiculous thing to think that, well, the largest class in Russia will carry out the revolution. Trotsky, drawing directly on Marx's writings in the 18th Brumaire of Louis Bonaparte, so talking about the revolution in France in 1848, he said the peasantry will undoubtedly play a huge role in the Russian Revolution because it's the majority of the population. But it will not provide the political leadership, and it will not carry out the tasks that we've already talked about on its own. The reason for that is the conditions of life of the peasantry is very isolated in rural communes or villages. There tends not to be a national organization of the peasantry that functions in a similar way to a workers' party. They are themselves property owners. You have a rural proletariat, as in people who don't own anything, but they are really part of the working class.
Sure. And you actually did have in 1905 the emergence of peasant congresses, but actually the spearhead of those congresses was agricultural labourers, more so than the small proprietors that made up the bulk of the peasantry.
Which, if anything, confirms what Trotsky was saying. So it's not completely ruling out the peasantry, but it's not giving them an independent leadership of the revolution. So who is going to do it? Trotsky said that the working class, an urban class, because ever since the advent of industrial capitalism, it's been the city that's been the epicenter of politics in capitalist countries. Working class is an urban class. They quite literally hold in their hands the levers of the economy. They're the ones carrying out the industrial base, the industrial production of the economy. Even a small working class starts to build up battle organizations like trade unions and parties. The working class is the only class that has the historical interest, the objective interest, and the means to actually lead this revolution and ironically carry out the bourgeois democratic task. So what he was putting forward is, if the struggle of the peasantry against this semi-feudal oppression and exploitation links up with the struggle of the proletariat for demands that you mentioned, Joe, like the 8-hour day, as well as the struggle for democracy, which is obviously something that does interest the workers as well, and the working class leads this alliance, if you like, of workers and peasants, then in overthrowing bourgeois rule, the workers won't set up a normal bourgeois government. They will actually overthrow the class rule of the bourgeoisie itself and carry out the bourgeois democratic tasks of the revolution for the bourgeoisie, if you like, but more accurately to say, for society as a whole. Finally, Trotsky as well, if you have a situation where the workers at the head of this revolution movement have actually established what is called the dictatorship of the proletariat, which would include the poor peasantry here and certainly the rural workers, what do they do next? Do they limit themselves just to carrying out land reform or to overthrowing Tsarism? No, the workers have their own interests. They have their own interest in eliminating unemployment, planning the economy. And so he says that the conclusion of the democratic revolution, which is carried out here by the workers as the only consistently, independently revolutionary class, it just grows over into the beginning of the socialist transformation of society.
In a permanent chain of revolutionary development,
exactly.
Hence permanent revolution.
That's what permanent revolution means. It's not you forget about the democratic stage. It's not complete the democratic stage and then 20 years later, let's try and have a socialist revolution. It is that actually, in order to really complete and achieve the democratic revolution, the workers must struggle for power at the head of all the oppressed masses, which necessarily leads on to the question of the socialist revolution.
I want to get on something different. We've quoted before on this show the address in 1850 by Marx to the Communist League, from which Trotsky cribs the specific title. I will read out a section in full, although we did talk about socialism in one country, to which this discussion is also relevant. Devoted an entire episode to that, which I'll put in the description for this episode. Think of it as like a companion piece to this episode, because really these debates go together. But Marx, talking about the experiences of the revolutionary wave of 1848 and the role that was played by the classes who were involved in that revolution, says, while the Democratic Petit Bourgeois want to bring the revolution to an end as quickly as possible, achieving at most the aims already mentioned, it is our interest and our task to make the revolution permanent until all the more or less propertied classes have been driven from their ruling positions, until the proletariat has conquered state power, and until the association of the proletarians has progressed sufficiently far, not only in one country, but in all the leading countries of the world, the competition between the proletarians of these countries ceases, and at least the decisive forces of production are concentrated in the hands of the workers. Now, one argument that was presented by Bukharin first, actually, in the 1920s, is that this conception of the permanent revolution, the Marxian one, to use his term, is different to Trotsky's. He basically argues that what Marx was talking about is the way in which one stage of the revolutionary process advances from each to the other. And he accuses Trotsky of taking the end of the process and putting it at the beginning. He says that Trotsky jumped the gun, essentially, and tried to put the proletarian revolution ahead of the democratic bourgeois revolution. Is that at all reasonable allegation? Is there a fundamental distinction between what Marx was talking about and the idea that Trotsky ultimately developed? I appreciate that's actually two questions, but I do want you to deal with both of them.
Yeah, that's fine. As for the first question about Trotsky putting the cart before the horse, no, that's absolutely not correct. For the reasons that we've already discussed, that Trotsky was actually talking about the achievement of the aims of the bourgeois democratic revolution by the proletariat at the head of the oppressed masses. So that stage is not, that stage, if you like, is not skipped. It is completed. But its completion means the coming to power of the proletariat. Hence, it grows over into the socialist revolution. So there's no reversal of stages or anything like that. But a more perhaps a point that deserves a little bit more time and attention is what Bukharin says about Marx's conception of the permanent revolution. Because at this time, when people like Bukharin are arguing against Trotsky, they know full well that Marx used this expression and that Marx was putting forward something very similar to Trotsky. And so the only thing that they could do to deal with it, to deal with this very thorny problem, was to distort Marx's views in order to then attack Trotsky. Bukharin's conception of what Marx is saying is that in any revolution, you have this succession of stages in which first the liberal bourgeoisie takes leadership, carries out its task. Bukharin talks about each class carrying out their own task. So first, the liberal bourgeoisie comes in, carries out its task in the revolution. Then it passes the baton, if you like, to the petty bourgeoisie, who come in and carry out their tasks in the revolution. And then at last, finally, the proletariat is given its chance to carry out its tasks in the revolution. And this gives a very nice, ordered picture of a progression through stages. Is that how revolutions actually work? Is that how any revolution has actually taken place? Perhaps that's too broad a question. But one thing I will talk about is the context in which Marx was writing himself. What were Marx's actual ideas? Marx wrote that address in 1850, March of 1850. 2 years prior, a revolution had erupted in a great number of the European countries, most notably in France and Germany. Marx actually went over to Germany and participated in the revolution. And what did he experience? What he experienced, as we briefly discussed already, was a revolution in which the tasks were bourgeois democratic, as we've talked about, unifying the country and so on, where the workers rose up, fought on the barricades. The liberal bourgeoisie were given more political power on the back of that movement, and they gave it back to the Prussian monarchy, you know, absolutist, semi-feudal monarchies, in order to do what? To put down the workers, because the working class was seen as a much bigger threat than the splitting up of Germany and the backwardness of Germany. They would much more happily do a deal with the Prussian monarchy in particular. The leadership of the revolution therefore passed to the petty bourgeoisie as a result of a defeat, counter-revolution, in fact. And because the working class at that time, you know, Germany's not even a unified country, as I've mentioned, so the working class is scattered across, in some cases, very, very rural and economically backward parts of the country. Half of the working class were still organized in guilds, which is a feudal form of organization. And in terms of the working class's consciousness and demands at this time, we're still talking about quite an early period in the evolution, if you like, of the German working class. The working class was not capable of taking power directly at that time, which Marx recognized. So instead, the leadership passes to the petty bourgeoisie. Do the petty bourgeoisie carry out their tasks, as Bukharin explains? Well, if their tasks are, again, unifying the country, introducing things like universal suffrage, which had been done in France in 1848, then they did not carry out any of those tasks. They completely and utterly failed. They actually tied their project, again, to the monarchy, albeit in a different way, I won't go into it, and the movement was crushed. And there was no proletarian stage. The proletarian stage was what Marx was looking forward to in the future. So what did Marx was writing Permanent Revolution, not because of the nice succession of stages, but precisely because the classes that were supposed to carry out their tasks did not. What is Marx saying? What he says, and I would recommend anyone read this address, because it's quite short and it's phenomenal, especially when you consider what happened later on in history.
I think it's one of Marx's most prescient pieces of writing, actually.
I would agree, yeah. And that's quite a packed crowd. That's quite a tough bar to meet. But what does he say then? In the future revolution, which he was anticipating, he said, look, due to its level of organization, its level of consciousness, you know, it's not unified into a revolutionary party yet, the working class is not going to just be able to take power directly. It's pretty much the liberal bourgeoisie has already made it very clear that they are a reactionary class that will actually oppose the revolution. So we can't expect anything from them. The workers cannot take power. Therefore, the democratic, radical petty bourgeoisie will inevitably come to the fore in some kind of, you know, provisional government or some kind of, you know, revolutionary regime of that character. What they will try to do is they will try to coax the workers into a single organization so they combine them to their demands. What are their demands? To limit the social demands of the workers in the name of democracy and unity amongst classes. Marx says that should be completely rejected. The workers should maintain their independence and their own organizations at all costs. If they have acquired arms in the course of the revolution, they should hang on to them and they should resist any effort to pacify them with force. Also, and I think this is incredibly significant, the workers, this is in the course of a bourgeois revolution, remember, the workers should set up their own councils, assemblies, or clubs. Clubs was the name given in France to workers' assemblies. Workers' councils that should form a state within a state, constantly monitoring, pressurizing, and undermining the official petty bourgeois democratic government.
You basically preempt the Soviets, the All-Russian Congress of Soviets, the dual power situation that emerged after February 1917.
Exactly.
The rudiments are all there.
Almost word for, I would say, he basically sets out the strategy that the Bolshevik Party followed after Lenin returned in April 1917.
And it's
pretty
no
much
accident.
Word for word.
And it's no accident that, you know, we've often argued, and we've been accused of sophistry, actually, for making this point, that the April theses are essentially Lenin endorsing Trotsky's theory of permanent revolution. The argument presented to us is that Lenin never explicitly said that he agreed with Trotsky's conception. I think that's actually false. There are actually quotes that you can draw on. Admittedly, they've been reported by other people where Lenin basically said, well, Trotsky was right in 1905. But I think that the essence of Trotsky's conception of the permanent revolution is absolutely contained in the April theses, because it says what? It doesn't say all power to the bourgeois provisional government.
No.
It doesn't say now we've dealt with autocracy, it's time to build bourgeois democratic capitalism. It's all power to the Soviets, all power to the workers' councils.
Exactly. What he said was patiently explain the need for the Soviets to take power, to prepare the working class to lead the revolution. In other words, we don't have this passive succession of stages where the liberal bourgeoisie basically betrays the revolution, then the petty bourgeois betray, and then the workers finally get given their turn. Lenin is talking about consciously striving to win the leadership of the movement and carry out the revolution. That is the genuine Marxist conception of revolution, opposed to an extremely passive, and I would say reformist one, which is what Bukharin's talking about.
When you were talking, I couldn't help think of a negative contemporary example in the form of the Sudanese revolution. In 2018, you had a dictatorship swept aside of Mohammed al-Bashir, and you had the coming to power of basically a transitional government made up of civilian elements, but also elements of the counter-revolutionary military junta. And the demands are all democratic. It's we want democracy, we want freedom of assembly, freedom of speech. And you had the emergence, basically, of a dual power situation in the form of the general strike and the sit-ins, particularly the big sit-in in Khartoum. But the workers never took power. And the bourgeois liberals, who made up the majority of the leadership of the revolution at that point, so people like the SPA, the Sudanese Professionals Association, the Forces of Freedom of Change, they were ultimately incapable of accomplishing their tasks, if you like, and laid the ground for a bloody counter-revolution. And now Sudan has been turned into a state of barbarism. I think that's quite a compelling negative demonstration of the permanent revolution in action.
I think you're right, because if we take Bukharin's standpoint and apply that, which many official communist parties have done in many, many revolutions, the initial stage of the revolution was liberal democratic in that it created this transitional government, which was power sharing between the liberals and the military. That was the liberal democratic stage. So they're supposed to carry out their tasks and then pass it on to the petty bourgeoisie. They did that in the form of counter-revolution, basically, allowing the military to carry out a counter-revolution.
That was the one task of the military junta, bide its time to wait for its opportunity to launch counter-revolution, which it did.
So presumably now, in this situation of horrifying civil war, this is the proletariat's turn, is it? We've now been allowed to try and struggle for power in a period where the working class is being bombed and attacked and destroyed in the weakest possible position.
Yes.
And this is also what, in Bukharin's lifetime, we saw this play out. In the Chinese Revolution that's already been mentioned, the reason Bukharin actually put forward this argument was to justify this idea of first you support the liberal bourgeoisie, when they turn on you, that means that their role has now been exhausted in the revolution. Then you find the radical petty bourgeois layer, which they did in the left Kuomintang, which split from the what became the right Kuomintang in the course of the counter-revolution. You support them in order to carry out their tasks. And you raise special slogans, which basically means you water down your slogans to be acceptable to them. And then they'll give the proletariat the go-ahead. Now, Chiang Kai-shek massacred communists. Then there was a left-wing split from the Kuomintang, led by somebody by the name of Wang, I think. And so the Communist Party's position was, well, support them. This is the petty bourgeois stage. Wang then carried out a massacre of communists. And then only at that point did the leadership of the Comintern say, now it's the proletarian stage.
Yeah.
Lead the struggle for power. And they did actually try to lead an insurrection in Canton. They set up a Soviet. But this is after the working class has already been attacked and killed several times.
Yeah, its forces have been decimated. Its organizational structures disrupted. The communists have been completely disorganized, thrown into utter disarray. Their cadres have been slaughtered. And at this point, you say, now the field is open for us, comrades.
Yeah, it's a sick joke, actually.
And we should say that we're not going to dwell on this question of stagism, which is part of the idea that's counterposed to the theory of permanent revolution, and increasingly became so after the 20s. There are so many instances in history. You could take the Spanish Civil War in the 30s, you could take the Indonesian Revolution, you could take all of the revolutions that broke out in the former colonial countries in the 20th century, where the line from Moscow to the communists, to the working class, was basically, wait your turn. This is a bourgeois revolution. We're at the bourgeois stage. Do not try to advance beyond those tasks. And what happens? You end up with a popular front formed, an allying of the working class and the communists with the so-called progressive national bourgeoisie. And the result is a complete massacre.
And that argument is often accompanied with the idea that if the workers put forward more advanced demands, should we say, put forward the idea of basically Lenin's slogan of all power to the Soviets, but in the conditions of a given country, that will split the movement. I've seen this argument made many, many times that it's all well and good to talk about class independence and all this kind of thing, but if the workers put forward their own independent position, all the other classes in society will turn against them. It will split the movement, and so the movement, where not only will the workers be defeated, but actually the entire revolutionary movement will be defeated.
I suppose the counterexample that people making that argument would use is China in the 40s, where they would talk about the allying of the progressive classes, including, they would say, the workers, the peasantry, and the patriotic or progressive national bourgeoisie.
That's not how the 1949 revolution took place, and the fact that Mao later expropriated the bourgeoisie shows that the bourgeoisie never played any progressive role in China.
Yeah, and as we were speaking, you could also look to the example of Cuba in 1959, where you start out with, you know, Castro and Che and the rest initially not socialists, not communists, not trying to lead a proletarian revolution, leading in their minds a revolution of national democratic liberation, a bourgeois revolution, if you like, but run headfirst into the reactionary role of the parasitic native bourgeoisie, the oligarchy, cooperating with Yankee imperialism, and eventually are forced to either move in a socialist direction or to cede the field to the counter-revolution. Don't have time for that here. We have an entire episode on the Cuban Revolution, which makes this point in more detail. So the next thing is actually, in a certain sense, going back in time. It's the OG criticism of the opponent revolution, which is the argument that Trotsky ignored or underestimated or simply didn't like the peasantry. And here, I'm going to quote the big man himself. This is Stalin writing. He says, "What is permanent revolution in its Trotskyist interpretation? It is revolution that fails to take the poor peasantry into account as a revolutionary force. Trotsky's permanent revolution, as Lenin said, skipping the peasant movement," this is a quote, he says, "playing at the seizure of power. Why is it dangerous? Because such a revolution, if an attempt had been made to bring it about, would inevitably have ended in failure, for it would have divorced from the Russian proletariat its ally, the poor peasantry. This explains the struggle that Leninism has been waging against Trotskyism ever since 1905. What do you say?
Well, I'll start with where Stalin's right, you might be surprised to hear. If, in a country where the working class is... I saw one source that said the biggest possible estimate, the largest possible estimate of the working class in Russia in 1917 was about 26 million. That's if you include household workers.
In a country of approximately 180 million.
What I saw was 125 million. Okay, so let's just take that for sake of argument. Working class is 20% of the population. Mm-hmm. In a country where the working class is 20% of the population and the workers on their own launch an insurrection, that insurrection will be almost certainly defeated. Mm-hmm. Because all the other classes will ally against it or at least passively support the counter-revolution. So if Stalin is saying that the workers should not just try to leap over the heads of all the other classes in society, mm-hmm. I would agree.
I don't mean to interrupt you again, or to drag it back to 1905, but actually, at the head of the Petersburg Soviet, that was part of Trotsky's consideration when, for example, he called off the second wave of the general strike in November, because he recognized through the way that risings in Moscow and Sevastopol were put down by peasants in uniform. In his mind, that was part of the reason that it was clear that the situation was not ripe for insurrection because the peasant mass was not in general behind the proletariat. A section of it was. I think there's some quote from Trotsky's History of 1905 where a uniformed soldier goes to a meeting of the Petersburg Soviet and says that one third or one fifth of the army is with the people. So already the peasantry is beginning to be won over, or its organized elements, but it was not as a whole won over, and it was actually used as a battering ram by the autocracy in order to crush the revolution.
Absolutely, and here we come to the point. So I've talked about where I agree with Stalin, but let's talk about where we disagree and where he's wrong, which is, was that ever Trotsky's position? What you've just mentioned is, I think, very powerful evidence that proves that that was never Trotsky's position. It wasn't his position in 1905, certainly wasn't his position in 1917, that Trotsky never dismissed. There's no example in Trotsky's writings or his speeches that I've ever seen in which he completely dismisses the peasantry and says the Russian working class can go it alone. What he does say about the peasantry, which is what Stalin's picking up on, is what I explained earlier on in this podcast about the peasantry can play an enormous role, must play an enormous role in a revolution like a country like in a country like Russia, but it cannot take the political lead. There has never in history been a pure peasant revolution. Even going back hundreds of years, the peasantry has linked up with some urban class. Mm-hmm. Even in the peasants' revolts in the 14th century, the peasants were able to get into London because this is a pretty young bourgeoisie at this time, let them in. I'm not going to go into detail about the peasant revolt, but there was an alliance established between the bourgeoisie and the peasants in that early movement.
We've had a few requests for an episode on the peasants' rebellion, actually, so maybe we should earmark you for season 4.
Yeah, maybe another day. But going back to the 20th century, Trotsky, and by the way, this was exactly Marx's position as well, that the peasants are not able to independently lead the revolution. They ultimately have to be led. I don't mean in that sense that they're led by some kind of pack animal. They're conscious human beings struggling to overcome their oppression. They are just as much as part of the revolution as the working class. But the working class, because of its conditions, because of its class nature and its organizations, is the one capable of actually overthrowing this oppressive regime. So Trotsky everywhere talked about the working class at the head of a movement of the peasantry and oppressed classes. Incidentally, that is exactly Lenin's conception, certainly during and after 1917. He actually wrote a short biography of Karl Marx, I think in 1918. And in that, he quoted very approvingly from something that Marx said in a letter to Friedrich Engels in 1856 about Germany. He said that if the proletarian revolution in Germany is backed up by a new edition of the Peasants' War, then the whole thing will go swimmingly. He said. What he means by the Peasants' War was it was a huge uprising of the peasantry in Germany in the 16th century, which was crushed, a bit like the Peasants' Revolt. So Marx here is saying that if you have a revolutionary movement of the peasantry, which backs up, in Marx's words, a proletarian revolution, then the revolution in Germany will be successful. Germany in the 1850s was a majority peasant country. The country wasn't even unified, and many of the German states were under absolutist monarchies like the Prussian monarchy. So, to a certain extent, it's comparable to Russia, although I'd say Russian industry was more advanced in the early 20th century than German industry in the 1850s. What Marx is here saying, and Marx made some, you might interpret them as dismissive remarks about the peasants. He said that their conditions of life, they're not integrated together, they're like a sack of potatoes. In other words, each potato is its own, like, you know, entity, and a sack of potatoes is just a collection of these isolated entities. What he means by that is that the peasants don't join, they don't become a conscious class fighting for its interests like the working class can. So Marx never ever entertained the idea that the peasantry could lead a revolution, but he did not say that the peasants are therefore always a reactionary or counter-revolutionary bloc. He said that the working class, if backed up by a revolutionary movement of the peasants, can take power. And Lenin quoted that in 1918, saying that is what happened in our revolution. That has been Trotsky's position ever since 1904, 1905. He never dismissed or ignored the peasantry. He recognized the different characteristics of the peasantry and the working class as different classes and their roles in the revolution. That's all.
So, I don't want to dwell on this question of socialism in one country for the reason I already said. We've already done an episode on it in its entirety. But I do want to hone in on one point, because some people argue that the mistake that Trotsky and Trotskyists make is that we overlook Stalin's arguments that it's not so much a case of abandoning the prospect of world revolution, and they point out that Stalin did actually say that ultimately the final victory, his words, of socialism would only come with world socialism. But in the meantime, it's possible and necessary to build socialism wherever you have a successful revolution. And if you delay that task while you wait for the world revolution, then actually you're playing a counter-revolutionary role.
We have to remember that there is Stalin in 1917, there is Stalin in 1927, and there is Stalin in 1937, and so on and so forth. And his ideas developed, if that's the right word to use.
They changed. Honestly, development implies progress.
They evolved or degenerated, depending on your point of view, to the point where it's true that in 1924, bearing in mind that the idea that you could build socialism, a fully socialist society, within the confines of the former Tsarist Empire, that idea had never been put forward in the history of Bolshevism. Not by Lenin, not even by Stalin. So in 1924, where this idea is introduced by Stalin and by Bukharin as well later on, he's having to balance with the Marxism that existed in the party at the time and the heritage of Lenin, which was you spread the revolution, the essential, the necessity of world revolution for the building of socialism. That was always a foundational principle for Bolshevism and the Communist International. So as a result, Stalin pays lip service. He says, oh, yeah, we still need the world revolution, of course, but we can actually build socialism on our own. So what in that case, if we can build socialism, then what's the need for the world revolution? It's to defend our socialist state against external intervention in, you know, in a military or political form. In other words, the role of the international and world revolution, the role of the working class in countries like Germany and Britain and so on, is to hold their ruling class back. If they go ahead and have a revolution, overthrow their capitalists, that's great. I'm sure that Stalin, certainly in the 20s, would have liked that. But that's not really, that's not the business of communists in Russia, effectively, was the standpoint. You start seeing an increasingly narrow, I would even say nationalistic, perspective on the world revolution itself. The world revolution becomes a series of just independent national revolutions, each take their own course. And that was fatal for the internationalism of the Communist International itself. Now, I've talked about 1924, but in the 1930s, Stalin dropped even that. In 1935, the leadership of the Soviet Union announced that they had achieved the final victory. They announced that they had succeeded in creating a society without the exploitation of world, of man by man, that they had built socialism. And therefore, from the standpoint of this socialist society, if they can just go it on by themselves and the next stage is the peaceful construction of communism, then what does it matter if there's a revolution elsewhere? It would be nice. But Stalin himself, in an interview with the American press, said it's a myth that we want world revolution. We don't want to export revolution anywhere. If the people of America want to have their own revolution, great. But we're not going to interfere. It doesn't matter to us, effectively. Now, that idea transmitted across the world to millions of communists is poison. And what did it lead to? It led to the dissolution, the complete dissolution of the Communist International itself, Lenin's International, and to the astonishing policy of so-called peaceful coexistence, by which I mean that in the Cold War period, the formal line, the official line of the leadership of the Soviet Union was that the socialist system, as they called it, so the Warsaw Pact countries, the socialist countries, could coexist with Western imperialism. To totally antagonistic, mutually exclusive systems of capitalism and imperialism, and the states trying to build socialism, as I see it, those things could just exist, coexist. Why? Because we've already built socialism. We will succeed in building the higher phase of communism in the next 20 years. At which point, communism will just gradually spread everywhere. That was their line. Now, I guess all I need to add to that is that what happened? Was that correct? So I think when we attack Stalin as abandoning the world revolution, we can't just take him on one quote in 1924. We have to take him throughout the whole course of his career and the disastrous consequences of that theoretical, I'd say mistake, but maybe a better way is to say a theoretical revision, a perversion of Marxism.
Yeah, and in so doing, we're only following our own standards as far as arguing that to understand the essence of Lenin, understand the essence of Trotsky, you can't just play quote ping pong, you have to actually look at the totality of their work and grasp the thread of their argument. So this has been a really fascinating discussion, and I'm going to bring it to a close with basically a proposition. And I make this with the fullness of spirit of comradely debate. I'm not trying to antagonize anybody, but I put it to you, and I put it to you, the viewer and listener, that what is implicit in the criticism of permanent revolution, it reflects a fundamental lack of faith in the working class anywhere in the West, in the colonized countries, in the developed countries, in the underdeveloped countries, to take the lead and to begin the tasks of socialism. And I've got a quote by Monty Johnston, who was a self-described Marxist historian, who says of Trotsky that in most cases he overestimated the revolutionary possibilities in such situations as, for instance, the 1926 general strike and France and Spain in the 1930s. He tended to see these revolutionary potentialities through the prism of the October Revolution. He was particularly wrong, in my view, on the popular front, against the Communist International and on the character of the Second World War, along with the Communist International. The broader point being that Trotsky always saw the possibility of the working class taking power alone, and he was wrong to criticize these alliances of convenience that the communists under Stalin took in various countries.
The conclusion of what Monty Johnson's saying is that in one of the most turbulent and disturbed periods in history. We're talking about the interwar period, the 1920s and 1930s. There was never any situation in which the workers could have taken power. And so if it's impossible for the workers to take power, then they shouldn't try to. That would be a disastrous failure. And if there's no need or there's no opportunity for the workers to take power, then there's no need for a revolutionary party of the working class. Why does any class need a revolutionary party to carry out a revolution? But if there's no chance, or if that would be futile, then there's no need to have any revolutionary party. Instead, the so-called communist parties can be just the left wing of a broader democratic movement. Now, we've already talked about a lot of historical examples. If we look into the history of Spain, it didn't result in a nice democratic republic. It resulted in the victory of fascism. Why? Because the so-called anti-fascist bourgeoisie ended up inviting Franco's armies in the Basque country in particular, and splitting the lines of the republic. It was the allies in this anti-fascist alliance that betrayed the working class. The subject of the Second World War is worthy of a podcast all by itself. But really, as you say, what Johnson is putting forward is that the working class should always just be basically a reserve and a support of one wing of the bourgeoisie or another.
Which is the exact same thing that the Social Democrats, the reformists,
yeah,
would say.
That exactly.
The role of a Labour Party, a Workers' Party, a Social Democratic Party is to be the loyal opposition in the capitalist government.
Yeah.
And at best.
It's exactly what the Mensheviks said in 1917. They said, don't struggle for power. You will fail. The working class is too weak. In other words, they didn't have to talk about faith in the revolutionary peoples of the East. The working class is too weak to take power. It will be crushed in a civil war. Therefore, it's irresponsible to do that. They were proven wrong in a positive way, but Monty Johnston was proven wrong in an incredibly negative and disastrous way many times over. And I think that considering the depth of the crisis we're living with in under capitalism today, to replicate that view and apply the view being put forward here, which is still very common, I would say, in many communist parties, would be to consign the working class and humanity as a whole to further generations of barbarism, of war, of misery.
Well, thanks so much, Josh. I think you've dealt pretty thoroughly with the misconceptions around the permanent revolution. And hopefully, if you came here with any questions or uncertainties or misapprehensions of your own about what Trotsky argued, about what this theory actually presents, then I hope this was a useful episode. We firmly believe that the theory of permanent revolution is an incredibly important contribution to the annals of Marxist theory. It's essential, actually, for understanding why the Russian Revolution was victorious, why so many revolutions in the 20th century went down to defeat, and the 21st century as well, actually, as we were saying about Sudan. And it provides a critical guide to action for revolutionary struggle in the future. That's why we defend Trotsky's contributions, his legacy, and his struggle to this day in our own fight to win socialism in not just one country, but in one country after another.
Thank you for having me.
And we'll see you next week.
A specter is haunting Europe. The specter of communism.
Communism. Stronger, more determined than ever.
Communism.
Communism.
The communist.
The communist.
The communist.
Dedicated to the establishment of a new order.
Just what is communism?
I'll guarantee that 10 minutes from now, a lot of you are going to have a new understanding of communism.